My name is Bob Liff, and this is the CUNY Forum, a monthly town meeting that brings prominent New Yorkers together with faculty and students of the Edward T. Rogowski Internship Program in Government and Public Affairs. When I was 8 years old in 1957, our family moved into Linden Houses in East New York. A year, as I later found out when I was a reporter, the city opened 15,000 affordable apartments in New York City Housing Authority projects alone at a time when federal support for housing was at its highest. By the early 1980s, there were just 500 federally supported NYCHA apartments opened. The situation in terms of federal support has not improved that much since, and today the biggest challenge for the largest number of New Yorkers is affording to pay for a roof over their heads. Mayor Adams' new administration has paid a great deal of attention to the city's burgeoning homeless crisis, which today copes with serving 45,000 men, women, and children, and an estimated 16,000 are single, about 75% of them men, living on the streets and in the subways, many suffering from drug addiction or mental illness. As one of our panelists today will describe, their reluctance to go into city shelters, even when forced out of the subway system at the end of the line, reflects both the poor conditions in those shelters and the difficulty in getting them the help they need in a supportive setting. About 30,000 of the homeless are in families, many with working adults, simply priced out of being able to afford skyrocketing in rents in a city where building plans are painfully short of meeting a need we have known about for decades. And when affordable housing is built, usually in the context of set-asides and what are otherwise market-rate buildings, the question that looms is, what is affordability? In a city where, as another of our panelists will detail, 75% of families cannot afford $2,500 a month in rent, setting regulated rents levels too high may make them affordable as defined under the law, but they are out of the reach of families, which in the view of advocates feeds a gentrification crisis, threatening to displace people who have lived their whole lives in their current neighborhoods. It's an issue as complex as it is dire. We're joined by three New Yorkers who take an active role in wrestling with the affordable housing crisis. Robert Mascali was deputy commissioner of the city's Department of Homeless Services. Barika Williams, who is joining us via Zoom, is executive director of the Association of Neighborhood Housing and Development, one of the city's leading affordable housing advocates. Oswald Feliz is a Bronx City Council member on the Housing Committee, representing, among others, Fordham, Belmont, and East Tremont. He's a graduate of Lehman College, and he was once a government intern watching us from the audience instead of as a panelist. Barika, let me begin with you. As we tape this, the eviction moratorium is about to be lifted after it was in place because of the COVID pandemic. Describe the level of crisis we're living in now.
So thank you, Bob, and to CUNY Forum for having me. Where we are right now is a very concerning and, quite frankly, terrifying time when it comes to thinking about New York City housing. We know that many families and households have been on the brink of eviction because they have been unable to pay their rent. Now, with the eviction moratorium lifted, we know the reality is we're going to have landlords start moving forward and moving through eviction filings, some of whom have been filing for evictions all throughout the pandemic, contrary to popular belief. At the same time that we are out of and have fully used up our federal emergency rental assistance dollars, so those funds that families could tap into when they needed rental funds and rental resources, and you combine that with a moment in time where we are seeing skyrocketing rents and housing costs, where, as reported in the New York Times, housing costs have jumped 33%, right? And so we put all those pieces together with the reality that unemployment and underemployment are incredibly high still. Many communities are still feeling the everyday effects of COVID, and we get to a very perilous time when it comes to the housing prospects of people not being able to afford where they are, potentially not having somewhere to go, and there not being government resources to step in and support.
Bob, again, as we're taping this, there was a great deal of attention on Mayor Adams bringing in social workers and police officers and mental health professionals to basically clean out some homeless encampments. One, I think, was under the BQE or under the Gowanus Expressway, and he is resolute that people cannot be allowed to live on the street. This is more of an individual issue as opposed to a family issue, that Barika. Where are these people going?
So the city has now announced that 150 encampments are going to be taken down quickly. It's not something new. There's always been taking down encampments, but he's concentrating, he's accelerating, but he's also putting a team together where social workers will accompany sanitation workers and police officers to try to get this done in a more humane way. Also, they're giving people warnings. In the past, they didn't give warnings, and some people lost all their belongings practically overnight. All of a sudden, the sanitation would show up and would dump their stuff in the truck. So that's an improvement on the situation, where they are going. They probably will not go into shelter because the reason they're sleeping on the streets is that they're afraid of going into the shelters. Shelters are notoriously dangerous. People have been robbed and assaulted, so they won't go there. What they need to do is improve supportive housing. It's something, I was a vice president of supportive housing for women in need. Supportive housing is where you take people who are formerly homeless, you give them an apartment, and you give them wraparound social services, you know, a psychiatric, drug addiction, whatever, and they have their own apartment. They don't want to go to shelters, so it's going to be very difficult to transition these people from living in a tent underneath an expressway into a shelter. Some of them will go, most of them won't, and the ones that do go, they want to go into what they call a safe haven shelter, which is a new concept we've seen in the last couple of years, which are much safer, much cleaner, and there's only two people to a room instead of 10 people to a room. So that's the way they're going to have to move them. It's going to be very, very difficult because right now, for every the outreach will reach 300 people in a night, and they'll only place 5% of them.
Because they won't go into...
Because they won't go for... They won't accept services. So this is an extremely difficult task. They're moving forward, but I think they're doing it in a more humane and coordinated fashion, although the advocates probably would disagree mightily.
Oswald, your district, I think it's important to say, was where we had that terrible fire that, you know, frankly created a number of homeless families, though I think many of them have been taken care of, but there are multiple deaths, and it's just a horrifying situation. When you listen to what Bob is talking about individuals, and you listen about the threat of impending homelessness that Barika is talking about, where is this going? Is the city committed to, is the city committed, and is the city able financially to work towards the dramatic expansion in affordable housing that it needs, especially when, unlike the 1980s, when Mayor Koch had all this vacant land that was basically, the land was free, so he was able to, he's able to put in, more than 100,000 units. Land is extremely valuable and not available.
Well, Bob, it is so good to see you and so good to be back right here at the CUNY.
This is really, by the way, let me just stop. It's very exciting for us on this show and in this program that one of our people has moved from the audience to the panel. So I'm sorry, go ahead.
Exactly, and I want to start by thanking the ETR internship program. 10 years ago, I was just a curious student who graduated from Bronx Community College, entered Lehman College. I entered the ETR internship program. I was able to intern at the New York State Senate, and I was able to learn so much. I was able to explore my passions in public service, government, and politics. And I was also able to help my community and get involved. And here I am proudly serving as the council member of my community. So I'm very thankful for all the doors that the program opened.
Well, we're thankful you're here.
Yep, not only to me, but also to so many students across our CUNY system and also across our city. The homeless crisis is well documented, and it's become beyond unconscionable. It's a very complex crisis. We have to take many measures to help resolve it. The first step that we have to work on is the problem that we have in the city of New York related to income discrimination. As a housing lawyer, I noticed that many families in homeless shelters, they actually have city FEPS vouchers, which is very similar to a Section 8 program at the federal level, but
it's a rental assistance voucher.
Exactly, mm-hmm. At the city level. Some of these families, a good number of these families in homeless shelters, they actually have these vouchers and they're able to afford rent. However, they're discriminated due to their income. Landlords flatly tell them, we cannot rent out due to the fact that you have this voucher. That is unlawful in the city of New York. We should be doing much, much more to enforce those laws related to income discrimination. The second issue is creating shelters where people feel comfortable. Those living in our streets have been loud and clear. They said they do not feel comfortable living in our homeless shelters, including shelters that in some cases have 20 individuals sleeping in the same room. We need to invest in SROs, single room occupancy housing, to make sure that every family, every homeless individual has access to a room where they could feel safe, where they could feel comfortable, and also they could also feel at home. We need to invest in SROs and also the safe haven shelters as well.
Barika, when we were talking before the show, we were talking about how the top of the market, you know, the Russian oligarchs, you know, they may not be living here, but the top of the market is kind of overbuilt, but there are different levels of housing, and that it's the bottom of the market, and to some degree, one level up, the kind of $2,500 to $5,000 a month rent area, which is most stressed. Is that correct?
Correct. And it's hard to understand, and it can be confusing as a family or a household in New York City looking for rent. But as you were saying, the very top of the market, that is where folks are investing their millions and billions of dollars. Russian oligarchs, think of it more like a luxury art market. And then we've got the rest of the market, right? And that spans from everything from folks who are renting two bedrooms from $5,000 and $6,000 a month to folks who are really struggling to make an $1,000 a month rent. And where we see, and this is where I think we and all of our research really shows, is that where most of the housing need, the overwhelming majority of New York City's need is the bottom of the market. That is where most of our residents are in terms of how much they earn. And that is where most of our housing need is and where there's very, very little vacancy in the housing market. So what are your options when you're a household that's making less than $75,000? Where do you go? And what we see is that people either stay in apartments that are unsafe, they double and triple up. So this is some of the phenomenal reporting that's been done around multiple different families or individuals who are living in things like basement apartments because that's the only way that they can make it work. Or to some of the folks in your audience and some of the students, you have students who are in 2, 3, 4 folks in a unit where folks would be like, I'd really love to just be with me or one roommate and be able to have a little bit more space and be able to study in quiet, but that's not feasible when you have to figure out how to pay $2,500, which is almost average for a new construction two-bedroom right now.
That's an average even in what's defined as an affordable unit. Is that
correct?
I
would say that's about the average in a market rate unit. In what we're seeing in new construction, most of the things that are coming online that don't have subsidy and are not part of, let's say, a federal or a city or state subsidy dollars, you're going to see a $2,300 to $2,500 for a two-bedroom and up. So what that means is the reality is most of the folks in New York City need the things that are below that, which means we're cramming a lot of folks into needing what is actually defined as affordable housing, right? They're considered extremely low income, very low income, which I think can be confusing for us, for me as a family to say, hey, wait a second, we have two earners in this household, we have a job, we have figured out how to have benefits, and you're telling me that we can't figure out how to afford an apartment in New York City that fits the size of our family, and where we are as a city right now is the answer may be no.
One of the things that's going on as we come out of the pandemic, God willing, we're coming out of the pandemic, we're waiting to see what the new variant may have an impact, is because so much of Midtown and downtown office buildings have been essentially emptied out and there's no indication that people are coming back. People are looking at turning hotels into essentially SROs, safe havens, but some form of SRO where you could put two people in an apartment. There is discussion of turning some office buildings, particularly downtown, into into housing, which is very confusing because they don't have plumbing. They don't have, you know, they don't have gas lines for kitchens, and they don't have, you know, plumbing for bathrooms and stuff. Is this the little boy putting his finger in the dike, or are these things, is this part of an entire package? I'll start with you, Oswald, but you all, you know, jump in and totally ignore me if necessary, please.
Yeah, the homeless crisis is very complex, and the housing and affordability problem is very complex. That is one part of the problem. I think another part of the problem is making sure that the affordable housing that we're creating is truly affordable. Why? It's very simple. Why call it affordable when most New Yorkers cannot afford it? As council member, I'm currently analyzing legislation to help build truly affordable housing. These developers are getting huge tax breaks, and I think developers should be giving more to our city. They should be helping us resolve the problems on the issue of affordability. Under my legislation that I'm currently analyzing, developers would be required to provide deep affordable housing, let's say 20% or 30% of the units of deep affordable housing, so that families earning, let's say, 40 to 50K and under, they could have access to those buildings. We face many challenges, and everyone should be contributing to the resolution of those challenges, including those developers that are getting those tax breaks. Also, we have to economically integrate our city, and by creating that type of housing where all our areas of the city have some type of deep affordable housing, that'll also help resolve that problem.
Well, empty hotels is really a great area for us to now expand supportive housing, because it could take years to build supportive housing. But if you have an empty hotel, you can convert that to supportive housing. However, there's a glitch in Albany right now. There's an excellent op-ed in today's Daily News written by Laura Masuch of Supportive Housing Network in New York and Brenda Rosen of Breaking Ground, where it seems as if $100 million or so has been appropriated to convert empty hotels to supportive housing. But they did not take out the regulations that pertain to this type of conversion. At first they took it out, and then they didn't take it out. And so
yeah, and what is that? There are
certain building department regulations and things of that nature. I think the major stumbling block may be that there's not going to be kitchens in these hotel rooms, but there could be small kitchenettes, and food could be provided by the provider. But all of a sudden, it seems like, you know, they've given $100 million. It's like giving the Ukrainian army bullets and not giving them guns. And, you know, so this may not come off the ground. And it's last-minute negotiations right now where they're trying to free up this money to be spent. Don't say we have to abide by these regulations, because if we do, it's going to be extremely difficult to convert a hotel into supportive housing. So we need a push on that, and we need it now.
Yeah, Barika, you were talking. I'm sorry, go ahead.
I was going to follow up on what Bob just said. I mean, absolutely, and applaud Laura and the Supportive Housing Network. And we've worked on this ANHD as well. Hondo was the bill that passed that enabled us to be able to look at hotels and convert them to housing. But this is one of the cases where government red tape and regulations may be getting in the way of us being able to move to making and creating the affordable housing that we need. And the problem is that really we've got a window to do this, that if we go too far and too long, you know, we all want to see New York City return and be better than it was before. But if we get back to the place where tourism is skyrocketing again, we're going to lose the opportunity to be able to use these hotels for affordable housing. So really, really have a moment and an opportunity to get this right. The same thing is that we're looking at now in our commercial landscape. We know that businesses are looking at return to the office very differently, that it's unlikely that we're going to have everybody back in the office 5 days a week continually. So what does that mean for all this underutilized commercial space? And one of the places that the city did previously do this is down in the financial district post 9/11, was to recognize some of these commercial buildings could become residential units. It takes more investment, it takes more work, but let's go ahead and move the red tape that needs to happen so that we can create more of the deeply affordable housing the council member was talking about in these communities where we have we have the bones, we have the shells to do it.
I want to ask both of you, both Oswald and Barika, and Bob jump in. Barika, you mentioned basement apartments. There's a move now in Albany to legalize them. You know, they gain their greatest awareness, notoriety, sadness, when a dozen people in basement apartments, which were illegal, which were unregulated, died after flooding because of the hurricane. And it seems that coming out of that situation, that people are looking to legalize them is an indication of the sense of desperation that people have, you know, at the highest levels of government. Am I drawing a link that's inappropriate, Oswald? I don't know.
We have a housing crisis. We have to make sure that we're taking advantage of everything within our toolbox. We know that families are using basements for living purposes, and we also know that basements could be used for living purposes in a safe way. So we have to just make sure that we're regulating it, making sure that they have everything needed to keep the apartment in a safe manner, including emergency doors and much more. But I think it is something that families have been using for a very long time, and we just have to make sure that we do it right and create a system where families can live there in a safe way.
Barika, go ahead, I'm sorry.
No, and the work around legalizing and making safe basement apartments has actually been going on for quite a while. I wanna applaud two ANHD members, Chaya, CDC, and Cypress Hills Local Development Corp, who have been working on and leading this work since the de Blasio administration. And made it an integral part of the East New York rezoning, saying we need to count this housing and we need to support this housing in the rezoning that's happening in this neighborhood. I think the council member is absolutely right. We know folks are living in these units. We know they're staying in these units. How do we legalize them so that we can ensure that they're safe, so that we don't end up with another Bronx fire in the basement or in an attic, right? And that's, I think, what was being talked about at the state, that unfortunately it doesn't seem like it's gonna be moving ahead, was not just basement apartments, it's the broader category of what we call accessory dwelling units. When somebody's living in an attic, when somebody's living above a garage, this isn't just a city issue. This is an issue of, you know, somebody now, as childcare continues to skyrocket, you have a parent-in-law or a relative who's living above a garage, you want them to be in a safe, habitable unit where they can also support you and your family, potentially with caregiving of whether it's kids or an elder. This is it's a broad issue, and actually is much further outside of New York City, and many of the places outside of New York City and New York State are much further ahead of us than on this.
I was very struck when I found that federal support yielded 15,000 apartments a year in the 1950s. Can we do, and we're sitting in a moment that's unique in that we have all this federal support as part of the pandemic relief funds. And so how we use that money is critical in moving forward. But is there any chance, does anybody see any potential of federal support for housing again?
One of the problems is that the NYCHA units that we have now,
right,
which is 180,000 NYCHA units.
With what, several hundred thousand people on a waiting list?
400,000 people, probably more, residing in them. So every year, a certain number of homeless families from the shelter system move into NYCHA, okay? They get a priority, whatever. Recently was revealed that instead of moving 2,000 families a year from the shelter system into NYCHA units, it's been reduced by 50% to 1,000. And this is because of some sort of bureaucratic nightmare on NYCHA processing these applications. I mean, here we have the units set aside for the homeless families, and we're not moving them into. Same thing's happening with supportive housing. You know, people are talking about this 2,500 vacant apartments, you know, and
or it's... Well, explain what that is. There's existing units that have not been filled.
They've not been filled. So people talk about, oh, you got 2,500 people on the street, just put them in it. No. There's five people waiting for every one empty apartment. People that have applied and been processed and are on a waiting list to fill these apartments. And it's just like a very slow drip, drip, drip coming out of the bureaucracy. They have to prioritize this. You have 2,500 apartments. They should be moving people into them much quicker than they are now. We have record low numbers of people moving into supportive housing. And we also used to have something called a New York, New York agreement, where the city and state would work together on supportive housing. And it worked out very well. But then de Blasio and Cuomo couldn't get together. And it fell apart. And we haven't had that New York, New York agreement for 8 years.
Now, it's also important, you know, there is, this is obviously an economic issue, but there's also a racial overlay. I mean, there is an overlay of, in particular, Black and Latino and Asian, who are actually demographically, you know, among the poorest people in the city, and these economic straits. So there is this very clear overlay, and it gets you into arguments, you know, with shelters and with some affordable housing issues, where you get into a fair share argument. Are you putting too many of these facilities in particular neighborhoods? I suspect, Oswald, you have to deal with this.
Absolutely. Our city faces a lot of challenges on the issue of housing, affordable housing, and homelessness. Every single corner of the city should be contributing to the resolution of the homeless crisis that we have. I think our affordable housing system is flawed. NYCHA has traditionally housed individuals of low-income households, but we have to make sure that every other neighborhood and every other development is doing the same. We need to make sure that every single affordable housing development allocates a good percentage of affordable housing or deep affordable housing so that every single corner of the city of New York could help resolve that challenge that we have. We can do it. We also know that there are thousands and thousands of vacant apartments. Now we just have to make sure that every corner and every neighborhood in the city of New York is helping house those individuals that need housing.
Barika, one of the things at the essence of why NYCHA exists is it exists as transition housing. You're supposed to move it. You're supposed to come out of, for want of a better word, you know, substandard housing, move into NYCHA for a couple of years, get your feet under yourselves, and then move on either to, you know, a co-op or a condo to try to establish equity. But because of the housing crisis, nobody leaves NYCHA. I mean, nobody, but virtually nobody. You know, people are staying 30 and 40 years when the model was to stay 5 or 6 years.
Yeah, and I think we just have to recognize that that given how tight our housing market is, especially for affordable and low-income units, that people are in those units not just for 30 and 40 years, but multi-generations, right? If you don't have anywhere else to go, then what you are going to do is inherit the unit from your parents or your grandparents or an aunt or an uncle. And I think this speaks to your last question and what Councilmember Felix just said, which is it is unconscionable that we have allowed wealthy and especially white communities to say, we're not going to participate in solving our affordable housing crisis. We're not going to participate in creating spaces for homelessness and being a place where we're going to include shelters. Every single corner and every single neighborhood of New York City has to and needs to do their part. That's the only way we're going to get out of this. And it disproportionately is hitting our Black and Brown and Asian communities, our low-income and immigrant communities. They're the ones who are bearing the brunt of this. And it's a very inequitable way to say that some people can opt out. Those with power and money and a lot of privilege can opt out of this process, and that everybody else in the city is going to have to absorb the totality of what the housing crisis looks like.
About NYCHA and the generational, we found when we did a study at Homeless Services that most families that were coming into the system were coming from NYCHA apartments where they were in overcrowded situations. You know, maybe the mother was there, then a daughter with a couple of kids, and maybe her sister came in. And so people would then come into the system and say, I can't live there, you know, it's overcrowded. And the city has a certain parameters they use, how many square feet per person or whatever else. But most of the families that were coming into the homeless services shelters were coming from NYCHA buildings.
And also, if I could go back to the earlier point, Right now, our city and our state has a very unique opportunity to help resolve the challenges that we have. Right now at the state level, the state legislature and the governor executive branch is analyzing the restructuring of the 421A program.
Right, the 485 is whatever it's being called now, right?
Exactly. So
explain what that is and why it's important.
The 421A program is a program wherein developers get tax breaks if they build affordable housing. But there's been a lot of challenges with the program and criticisms, including number one, that landlords aren't providing the legally required rent levels. They're providing them much more expensive than they should. But number two, that the rent levels that landlords are required to provide, they're not affordable at all. So I think right now the legislature is discussing the restructuring of the program. This is a very unique opportunity to build a system wherein we could truly house, provide a good system of housing for all New Yorkers, including providing, let's say, 30% of a new development for deep affordable housing, including homeless families, let's say an additional 30% for middle class families, and then 40% for other.
One of the things
Sorry, Bob, on that, because I think one of the unfortunate things about the governor's proposal 485W is it unfortunately doesn't do what the council member just said, which is, you know, I think we know oftentimes what we need in our communities. And he talked about let's do some deep affordability, let's do some middle and moderate income, and then potentially maybe have some space for some market rate units. And none of the proposals on the table have any more than 25% affordability. And the one that has 25 or 30% affordability is at 90% AMI. Which is area median income. So that means that it's for a family making a family of three making $96,000 a year, which is not most families. It's not the average family in New York City. Average for us is much further down, around $75,000. So I think the question is, this program 421A has cost us about $1.7 billion a year in tax breaks that go to developers. I think the question is, if we said, council member, here is how much money your district gets, what would you want to do with it? And let's design the program around that. I think many of us in the housing community say, let's start from that, because I actually think the council member knows what he wants, and he knows what his community needs, and he's going to have those conversations. And I think the concern is when it goes up to Albany and gets driven by real estate, that we end up with a very different looking program.
The public advocate, Jamani Williams, who's running for governor, part of his housing plan was to have, I'm pretty sure they were fully affordable, and that some people would be at a very low AMI, and the AMI, the area median income, doesn't only include New York City, but actually includes the suburban counties where you have a significant income disparity from people who are living in the inner city. And that some people everybody would be paying 30% of their rent. So if a poorer family moves in, they're paying 30%. If a wealthier, relatively wealthier family moves in and is paying, 30%, that the relatively wealthier families, 30% would subsidize the costs of having the lower income people, and then there would have to be state subsidies. I mean, is there a ferment of ideas floating around? Is there at least now a broader recognition that something has to be done?
Well, I think it's good because there's so many different labels out there, and low, moderate, high. I think Jumani's onto something. Let's make 30% across the board, 30% of your income towards rent across the board, instead of having so many different categories. And then we can then do the subsidies, which is probably going to be complicated. I'm not that familiar with it, but I think we have to simplify this, because then it turning one against the other, and also it becomes very complicated. And those AMIs, and I did some research, and a family of three, which is a typical family in a homeless shelter, the AMI would be under 30% rule would be like $48,000. Only 20% of the families are working, and I mean, the rent then would only be around $900 or $1,000, but it doesn't really affect the families that are in shelter. It keeps family out of shelter, it keeps families out of shelter, but the families that are in shelter We have a great opportunity right now. We just got 8,000 federal Section 8 vouchers, unheard of in the past number of years. I don't know what the plan is, but we have those 8,000 vouchers, and we should put them to use as soon as possible. And I think homeless families should be one of the top priorities.
Barika, you made the point that there are landlords who will not, I can't remember if it was you or it was Oswald, made the point that there are landlords who will not accept rental vouchers. And I think it may have been you, but, that's kind of a discrimination that really can't be allowed to stand. And also you made the point, Barika, I'm gonna let you guys go on this, that 30% is a lovely goal, but some people are paying 50% and more of their income in rent. So, Oswald, talk about this.
I think there's a lot of different ways that we could help resolve that challenge. The wealthiest New Yorkers, aka the wealthiest developers, are the ones that usually get the biggest tax breaks. We should be requiring that they do much more for our city. There's many ways that we could help resolve some of the many different steps that we could take to resolve this challenge. I think this is a problem that we need to tackle from different angles. One angle is potentially requiring that for their vacant units, they turn it into deep affordable housing and require that the tenant pay no more than 30% of their income in rent. Let's say for tenants that earn, or households that earn up to $40,000 to $50,000. So there's many different ways that we could help resolve it. I think we should be taking many different approaches at the same time so we could tackle the issue from many different angles.
Barika, go ahead.
And it was the council member who talked about source of income, which is a great thing to bring up as a housing lawyer, he knows. But it is illegal, not just in New York City anymore, but now across all of New York State, to discriminate against anybody for their source of income. So that is to say, I am not going to rent with you because you have a voucher. That's illegal. And I want to give credit to the folks over at Zillow and StreetEasy, who worked with the city to launch a campaign saying, I vouch for vouchers, to try to really encourage and amplify the need to accept vouchers across the board in their real estate market. I think what the public advocate has been honing in on has really been for in some of ANHD and our partners' work around our Right to a Roof campaign, that every New Yorker deserves a right to a roof. And we have to recognize that the pathway to doing that is to say, we're going to cap everybody and not expect anybody to be rent burdened. Because the truth is, for folks who are making less than $80,000, they make up about 85 to 90% of our rent burden population in the city. And what that means is they're making decisions to not pay for medicine. They're having trouble paying for food. They're not accessing the healthcare needs that they need to because they have to put that money to their rent and to their housing costs. And quite frankly, we end up paying for that as a city one way or the other, because somebody ends up in the ER because they haven't done the preventive care that they needed to, right? Somebody now doesn't earn as much over the course of their lifetime because they didn't have the funds to put to their education that would put them in a better earning and income perspective over time. We just have to appreciate that this is costing us as a city, it's costing us overall.
And also, if I could add to the income discrimination issue, landlords are violating those laws very openly. Not too long ago, I was actually helping a tenant apply for different apartments via Zillow and many other different applications and websites. We actually sent over an email to a landlord, and we received an automated reply saying, thank you for reaching out. This is my number, we'll get back to you as soon as possible. Also, we do not accept Section 8. So they're doing it so openly that they even include that information on their automated emails. That is a problem. They're very open about it. It's a problem in the city of New York, and our city and state needs to do much more to enforce those laws because it's severely contributing to the homeless problem that we have in our city.
A lot of these people...
Bob, can I just add one thing on that? And because we've mainly talked about rental housing and NYCHA and homelessness, but another place that we see this kind of housing discrimination show up is in our home ownership market. And you touched on folks coming out of NYCHA and going into condo co-ops and condos. One of the other places that we know there is a significant amount of housing discrimination and very little oversight and enforcement is in co-ops and condos. Why am I being denied my co-op association application? Why was I turned down? And really, we do not look at that as a city. We do not question that. They don't have a lot of rules or structures. And so we know that there are places where co-op associations and condo associations are pretty openly discriminating against folks because of their immigration status, because of formal criminal justice exposure, or because of their race, even because of their family composition, saying, we don't want any little kids in this, and we see that you have little children. All of those things are against the law, and we have to tamp down on it as a city.
A lot of these issues, we're talking about the issue in the aggregate, but of course people suffer one by one, family by family. And a lot of this winds up in housing court, which is grotesquely overburdened. We have a right to counsel for people who are facing housing court, but there are not enough lawyers for them. I don't know who wants to do it, but tell me about right to counsel, and tell me about good cause eviction, which is a major cause that housing advocates are arguing that landlords should be able to pose a reason in order to evict somebody, as opposed to presumably on some kind of a whim. I mean, talk to me about those bills.
So after years of fighting, advocates were able to win a right to counsel, which is to say, if you're below a certain income and you end up in housing court, your landlord takes you, there are some circumstances where you end up in housing court, you should have legal representation. You're walking into a legal proceeding without anybody there to represent you. And what we have realized and what became very clear once right to counsel was enacted and available is that many of the folks who were ultimately being evicted because of the right to counsel or chose to leave on their own because they were fearful of going through court proceedings actually didn't need to leave their home. It was that they didn't have the legal services and supports to be able to defend their rights and defend that they were in the right to be able to stay in their home or in their unit, or maybe their landlord violated their rights and that their landlord needs to be correcting for things. This continues, and this conversation is expanding with a push for good cause, and I cannot urge Albany enough to pass and legalize good cause. This is something our neighbors in New Jersey already have, so this is not something that is like that should be deemed as earth-shattering or so destabilizing for the housing markets. It's to say, at the end of my lease, my landlord needs to have a reason that they're either kicking me out, ending my lease and not offering me a new lease. Maybe they need to take it back because they have a kid or a relative who wants the unit. Maybe why they want to renovate the whole building. There are absolutely good causes for when a landlord needs to use a unit, but just because they look at me and they say, you know what, I want to charge somebody $400 more because I don't like you anymore, that's not necessarily a fair reason. And what you're doing is removing me or a family or somebody else from a home. And we really need to think about what that does, not just for that individual, but for all of us as overall.
Let me go to Ernesto Malave Jr. and see if we have a question from a student.
Hello, my name is Ernesto Malave Jr. I attended John Jay College, but as a Hunter urban planning student, I'm going to turn the tables because we have a former student as a panelist today. So as assistant director of the Edward T. Rogowski internship program, I want to ask him a question. One of the things that happens is that when government and developers and others get together and do have good ideas that can affect homelessness, we experience something called NIMBYism, or not in my backyard syndrome. I live in Woodside, where that was a very prominent feature of several elections so far. How do you deal with situations where the good ideas are there, the investment is there, but then the community and the residents don't want to accept what is being put on the table?
Yeah, thank you so much for the question. We face a lot of challenges, and most individuals in the city council agree on the solutions that need to be taken. Now, the big question is whether every single council member or state elected official is practicing the principles that they are that they're preaching and that they're talking about during speeches and press conferences and much more. It's all about accountability. We have to have those difficult conversations. We need to resolve the homeless crisis, and every single elected official has to contribute, or every single community has to help resolve it. And we all have to practice the principles that we're preaching, including obtaining housing and fair share and much more. It's a difficult conversation, and we have that problem of NIMBYism. We have to hold every community accountable when they're not helping resolve the challenges that we have.
One of the points, Bob, that you've made is about you can measure communities that send people into homelessness and to what degree they are accepting, you know, facilities that will provide housing.
Yeah, the city has statistics on how many people from a particular community board are in shelter. And so they can make an argument, you've sent 300 people into shelter and you don't have a shelter in your community. And I've, one of my jobs, one of the most difficult jobs I had as a deputy was to open new shelters. And I can remember trying to open one up in East Flatbush, who had sent about 200 families or more into this shelter system and had no shelters, and we tried to open up a family shelter in East Flatbush. And the community was pushed back very, very hard on it. And we had public hearings, we had rallies and everything else. Some of the elected officials were adamantly against the shelter, but then one came forward, and that was Yvette Clark. She was a councilwoman at the time, and it was a real profile of courage.
She's now a congresswoman.
It was a profile of courage. She got up and said, I accept the shelter. And even though they had sent all these families at the shelter, they still didn't want, you know, a shelter in their neighborhood. And in that case, there's really no justification when you're sending so many families or individuals into the shelter system to not accept, you know, a shelter in your community. But I think the big point is, and the mayor's making this, well, we should stop looking to open shelters, really, unless you're going to open a safe haven shelter, because these congregate shelters are really very costly. It's $140 a night, believe it or not, to keep a single adult in a congregate shelter. They don't have the services that they need. They're in many cases not that secure. We should be concentrating on supportive housing, on safe havens, and getting away from congregate shelters. And also increase the number of drop-in centers. These people can come off the street, they can get food, they can take a shower, they can get clothing, get medical care, and they're in a drop-in center where it's brightly lit and they don't have to worry. And at the end of the night, they can be taken to a bed in either a church, a synagogue, or some other participating nonprofit. But the congregate shelters really it's a very flawed and passé model.
When you talk about this particular East Flatbush shelter, I mean, we saw under the de Blasio administration that they opened a shelter on East 58th Street right near Billionaires Row, which became fraught with a debate that had symbolism run amok, if you will. And is your community, Oswald in particular, they understand the need? I mean, have you seen struggles against shelters? I'm familiar with a particular shelter that's been proposed, for instance, in Chinatown, which has like five shelters within several blocks. So, you know, I mean, and a fair share argument is a very powerful argument, especially when city council members have some sense of member deference who can kind of block things from coming into their neighborhoods, though that seems to be weakening as a principle. It's complicated stuff.
Absolutely. And the fair share argument is an argument about equality, making sure that, again, every single neighborhood is helping resolve the challenges that we have. Right now, we have a system where generally we look into, at least as of now, which community boards have shelters and which ones don't. I think we need to do much more than that because what we've seen, including the Chinatown example that you mentioned, but also a recent example in my district, is that some community boards have a very low amount of shelters. And basically, they usually, whenever they do bring shelters, they include them in the same region. We should be looking at it not by a community board as a whole, because a community board could be diverse in every way, including economically diverse. I think we should be looking at it more specifically based on zip code. I think that is a better alternative to help make sure that every zip code in the city of New York is building shelters and helping house those that need housing.
A lot of the discussion about homelessness, Barika, is because so many families are on the verge of homelessness. And, you know, it certainly seems as if it would be financially beneficial to the city to keep those people in their homes. And, you know, I think Mayor Adams has kind of trying to change the debate. Mayor de Blasio, because he didn't have free land, you know, moved towards mandatory inclusionary housing, that any development over a certain size had to have 25% of affordable units, whatever that level of affordability is, which was always, you know, a problem. Is Adams embracing this issue appropriately?
I mean, I think Bob's touched on some of what's been happening around clearing of various different shelter encampments. I think it seems to skew, I think it's problematic, but B, it seems to very much skew the understanding of who and what homelessness looks like in New York City. That very heavily focuses on our single adult homeless population, and actually one of the growing shares of populations in homelessness is families. So the question is, what are you going to do with a family, and especially families with children, to be able to get them from a place of homelessness into being housed, right? Many of us would say that the option for that is to create more supportive housing, invest in more deeply affordable housing, and let's take folks from any kind of shelter or temporary housing status as short and as little as possible, because to Bob's point, $140 a night congregate shelter is a more than $3,000 a night apartment unit. So couldn't we just get them into a more affordable apartment unit, stabilize them over time? They're already investing that money. So I think there really needs to be some understanding and appreciation of what the short-term fixes are costing us and how much it makes more sense to invest in some of the longer term solutions, and especially focusing on some of our keeping people out of homelessness and our homeless populations that are families and families with children.
That figure was for a single adult. Shockingly, right. A family is $200 a night, or wow. $6,000 a month it costs to keep a family in shelter.
One of the points you've made in our discussions is you do have a significant number of drug addiction issues, mental health issues for single adults, but that's not the case with families by and large. That by and large, families can't afford to pay the rent.
Well, I have to tell you, yes and no. Mm-hmm. The major cause of family homelessness right now is domestic violence. And they're coming in, and only about 25% of those families that come in and they're accepted, and it's not easy to get accepted, into the shelter system with DV status are not getting DV services. The DV shelters do not really address the issue. There's not enough of them. So they get put into a regular family shelter, and most likely they're getting little or no DV services. So that's really a big problem is the DVs. People are also coming from overcrowded situations, as I mentioned before. With the evictions, the city will do whatever it can to keep people from being evicted. They'll give you these one shots. In other words, say you haven't paid your rent in 6 months and you're going to get evicted. The city will go back and give you maybe $5,000, $6,000, $7,000, $10,000 in a one shot, because they know how expensive it is to put them in shelter, to keep them out of shelter and keep them in their apartment. So they're making that effort. But we see, I have to tell you, that there's a tremendous amount of people that are on the verge of coming in. There's 200,000 eviction cases pending. Can you imagine if only 10% get evicted, and that's 20,000 families, and say only half of them show up? 10,000 families show up at the intake center near Yankee Stadium. I don't know if that's in your district, on Walton and 151st Street.
Almost.
It would be an absolute disaster. We would have to go back to putting them in into hotels, the families. And in those hotels, there's no kitchens. And it becomes very difficult.
And I just want to follow up on that, because that 200,000 number, we know it's still a low number, and it's an underestimate, because any person or family that applied for emergency rental assistance to the state, even though that program has run out of money, they currently still have rental protections. They're not allowed to be evicted because they have a pending application. But at some point in time, something is going to have to happen with all of those folks. Either we're going to find more money to support the folks who are in the pipeline, or at some point their status and protection of not being able to be evicted is going to stop. And we're going to see that 200,000 number skyrocket even higher. So then what do we do, right? Because now we're talking about two Yankee stadiums. We're talking about the Yankees and the Mets and the Giants and everybody's stadiums potentially being full.
Oswald, we have about 30 seconds left. I'm going to give you the last word, since we're making a big fuss over you here. Are you encouraged that there's both the will and the financial wherewithal to make a serious dent in this problem?
I am encouraged, and I'm also positive about the future. We have all the tools to help resolve the problem that we have with affordable housing and homelessness. Now we just have to make sure that we're making it a priority. We live in the wealthiest city in the history of Earth. We have to use our wealth to help the neediest.
I'm getting the goodbye sign. I was a reporter. I always make deadline. I want to thank you all. This is very, very spirited.
Thank you, Bob.
And we'll see you next time on CUNY Forum. Thank you.
Yeah, our pleasure.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bob.
Bye-bye. Thanks.